Our last speaker this evening is Gareth Pearce, a human rights lawyer, senior partner at Bernberg Pearce and Partners, who represented Mozambique and Anis Sada, amongst others. Gareth is best known for her work and advocacy in high-profile cases involving allegations of human rights injustices. Gareth also represented many ex-Guantanamo detainees. In 30 years as a lawyer, Gareth has represented the Guildford Four and the Birmingham Six, amongst others.
Each of the cases, the injustices that have been spoken about have certain resonances. Each of them is determined by a view, a narrative of complex world conflicts, one way or another. Munir Faruqi was a man who had a history of involvement a long time before, at a time when that involvement was never viewed as terrorist activity. Anis Sada was in Iraq in 2007, in a conflict, if you call it a conflict, that was triggered by the UK and the US invasion in 2003. And the narrative under which cases now are being prosecuted and were prosecuted, the narrative under which many men and occasionally women are now in British prisons, was a narrative determined effectively by the Prime Minister, Tony Blair, who said, "When I saw the planes going to the Twin Towers, I suddenly realized, before the pieces fell, that this was a kaleidoscope and the pieces of the map of the world were joined up and I could see it very clearly. Before the pieces fell, we had to reorder the world." If you were ever to read his memoirs, I recommend it. These are the words he used. And the world he saw that had to be reordered was a world in which the conflicts that he saw in a joined up pattern that had to be eliminated, he described it as a virus to be exterminated, were liberation movements in Egypt, in Libya, in Algeria. He saw them around the world as a joined up pattern that had to be tackled. And what we are now working through in our criminal justice system is the way we have applied that narrative and determined what is terrorism and what is not. And in the process, we have accused individuals before the courts who are part of an accused community, the Muslim community. And those individuals, defendants, awaiting trial, on trial, making decisions about what they should do at trial, know, and they know it with good reason, that they are part of a whole community in this country that is not just viewed with suspicion, but found guilty in much of the public determination before they stand trial. And that their jury, the jury who will try them, will see them as part of that community and will believe in advance of the trial that they are guilty. But guilty of what? This is the question. And there are a host of young people now in prison, awaiting trial or convicted, or who have pleaded guilty, who have no idea why they are guilty. Absolutely no idea. The definition of terrorism is so expansive that anyone can be caught on it. And you can go to a lawyer, even an experienced lawyer, and say, am I guilty or not? Will I be found guilty or not? And the lawyer will be unable to tell them, or profess to be unable to tell them. The definition of terrorism is that if by the use of violence, any form of violence, not necessarily serious violence, by the use of violence, you attempt to influence a government, any government, for a religious, ideological, or political purpose, that is terrorism. That is terrorism. And it doesn't matter what or who the government is. And so a succession of men, including Moisen, have been prosecuted on the basis of going to a country, Syria, where a ruthless, brutal dictator, who with his father had a 40-year history of what was described as a one-party democracy, a 40-year history of torture and false imprisonment, and in some cases genocide of its own citizens. When that brutal dictator responded to peaceful protests, part of the Arab Spring, by mass killings, brutal torture, when there was a response to that the prosecutors in this country determined was terrorism. To fight a man committing war crimes, dropping barrel bombs on civilian populations, eliminating city after city, town after town. So Syria now doesn't exist in its urban areas. It's like looking at Stalingrad in World War II. It is a crime to have gone to Syria to join the Syrian people to act in self-defense. That's what the prosecution says in case after case after case. And the two young men that Moisen referred to, who have been sentenced to 12 years in prison, were advised to plead guilty. To plead guilty to being terrorists. For having gone to Aleppo, not joined any prescribed group at all, to have worked with a brigade in which they were not good enough to be soldiers. They were put to look after children, and to pick up dead bodies when there'd been a bombing, and take them to the wall. That's what they did. That's why, as Moisen said, they're traumatized. They're both suffering from colossal post-traumatic stress disorder. And they've been sentenced to 12 years. But their lawyer said it's terrorism because it ticks the box of resistance to a government, any government. Assad is a government. That is terrorism. Now, whatever your legal prowess or not, it takes common sense and simple morality to say if that's the law, it cannot be just, it cannot be lawful, it cannot be right. And if, as Moisen said, our own government, Haig was standing up in Parliament at the time, saying, at all costs, this regime has to be taken away. We do not recognize Assad as the lawful regime. Well, if our government does not recognize it as the lawful regime, what are we doing prosecuting people for resisting that government? And so, in a number of cases, their lawyers to mount an aggressive pre-trial strategy. Moisen was one. Moisen said, this is what I did. I went to train people to fight so that they would not be killed in the process of defending the Syrian people. Simple. If that's unlawful, then that's what it is. But I do not believe it's lawful. I believe there is an international obligation and a moral duty and an international defense of self-defense. It's basic self-defense. It cannot be trumped by terrorism. Self-defense is an entitlement of the human race. And terrorism, whatever the expansion of the definition, cannot take it away. And so the aggressive strategy of saying in advance of a trial, this is my defense, it's not going to be an ambush defense, there's no secret, this is what I'm saying, I was there in Syria, in Aleppo or Idlib. We're not talking about ISIS, we're not talking about described organizations, we're talking about defending the Syrian people, saying, okay, this is my defense. Having said it, you, the government, have a duty to disclose. Prosecution, we want disclosed to us precisely what the government knows about the shipping of arms covertly from Libya via Qatar to Turkey in trucks to the rebels. We want to know what MI5, MI6 were sitting in those meetings. We know they've been mentioned in the press. We can see enough to know it's not speculative, tell us. And we want to know what you mean by supplying non-lethal support to rebel forces. If you're supplying non-lethal material support to rebel forces, night goggles, body armor, machines, trucks, that is supporting terrorist activity. So we want all the details of that, please, too. Moisen's case was dropped without explanation. The next man's case, Ben Hamidi, a young Libyan who fought in the Libyan Revolution, was accused of supporting Syrian resistance. That case suddenly dropped. Next one, Berlin Gildo, Swedish man, on to Syria, joined the fight. Gone back to Sweden, had the great misfortune to be taking a flight in transit through Heathrow. Nothing to do with England, no connection with England. Arrested and charged with terrorist activity because of what he'd done. Not a crime in Sweden, not a crime in Syria. But going through that case, suddenly dropped. So what I'm trying to say here is there is no place in the criminal law for uncertainty. The law is meant to be clear. Every person is meant to know how he or she can adjust their behavior so they know are they transgressing the law or not. And it's not only our prisons are full of young people who should not be there, who have not, in all morality or fact or conscience, transgressed any law that can properly be called law. It's not that. It's not just that. The penumbra beyond those people is terrified too. The wives of people who've been to Syria, who fear their children are about to be taken away from the social services, looking at whether the children are radicalized or not. Little tiny children. It's a nonsense. Charity workers who've given their lives since 2011 to driving convoys to Syria, taking aid, terrified because are they being arrested or not for contributing. Charities, the chilling effect on giving money. Are we breaking the law or not? It isn't just the enormity of an individual going to prison. The taking away of freedom, the taking away of life, the taking away of everything dear to a person. It isn't just that, it's the imprisoning of minds and choices and freedom, breathing free. That's all been taken away too, so that there is an imprisonment of thinking. And who are the prisoners? Who are the jailers? All of us. All of us who just let it.